The Academy of Fine Arts in Brera is one of Milan's most iconic institutions and one of the most prestigious laboratories of Italian modern art. In the mid-1870s, two young students met there. One, Carlo Bugatti, was the son of a Milanese architect. The other, Giovanni Segantini, was a homeless painter, born as an Austrian in Trentino, transferred to Milan as an unrecognized Italian, and discovered there by a reformatory chaplain. Both of them had gotten in touch with the scapigliati, a group of disheveled poets, musicians, and painters, really the Italian version of the French bohemian, who aspired to rejuvenate Italian culture after the country's unification. The scapigliati, or as the artists called themselves, the avveniristi, literally the futurists, did not have a formal school or manifesto, and their season was short-lived due to illness, addiction, or financial failure. Their work, however, had a long-lasting influence on Milanese life and Italian culture. The writers Ugo Eugenio Tarchetti, Arrigo Boito, and Emilio Praga, who brought the art of Gautier, Baudelaire, Poe, and Wagner to Italy, experimented with a new kind of poetry, interrelating elements from different sensorial realms through synesthetic effects. Tarchetti was the inspiration for the scapigliato Eugenio Torelli Violier, who founded Corriere della Sera in 1876, now Italy's leading newspaper. Arrigo Boito was the librettist for Verdi's operas Otello and Falstaff. His older brother Camillo was the author of the short story Senso, inspiring the 1954 neorealist masterpiece by Luchino Visconti, as well as the founder of Arte Italiana Decorativa e Industriale, Italian Decorative and Industrial Art, the journal which launched the program of applying art to industrial production as really an early laboratory of Italian design. Emilio Praga was the author of Penombre, Twilights, the poetic collection aspiring to be the Italian equivalent of Baudelaire's Le Fleur du Mal, The Flowers of Evil. But he was also the real embodiment of the poet maudit, like the cursed poet. His dissolute life, marred by alcoholism and drugs, would be the inspiration for the character of Rodolfo, protagonist of Puccini's opera La Bohème, whose libretto by Luigi Illica and the scapigliato Giuseppe Giacosa immortalized the movement. In parallel with poets, the scapigliati painters Emilio Longoni, Gaetano Previati and Giovanni Segantini, all classmates at Brera, developed a new style, which matured in dialogue with French chromoluminarism or pointillism as Italian divisionism. In their common apprenticeship as scapigliati, the ebonist Bugatti and the painter Segantini started a lifelong friendship at Brera. In 1879, Bugatti introduced his sister Bice to Segantini, who would become her lifelong partner. Due to his unclear civic status, he was neither Austrian nor Italian, they relocated to Switzerland as an unmarried couple, and Segantini developed his painting career in St. Moritz, where his museum is still located today. As a gift, for the start of their life together, Bugatti designed his first pieces of furniture for them. And that would be the start of his extraordinary career as an ebony artist. A year later, in 1880, he also married. With his wife Teresa Lorioli, Carlo would have three children, Ettore in 1881, De Anice in 1883, and Rembrandt in 1884. And of course, as you can guess, his uncle Segantini had a hand in the choice of Rembrandt's name. After perfecting his craft at the Academy of Fine Arts in Paris, Carlo Bugatti started working for the Milanese ebonist Mentasti. In his early designs, he modeled furniture with the same blend of pseudo-Moorish design and Japanese naturalistic elements that he had adopted for the bedroom suite that he had produced for his sister. But over time, his style evolved into a singular mix of exoticisms and eccentricities. His innovative design in the crafting of silverware, textiles, ceramics, and furniture was first recognized in 1888 at the Milan Fine Arts Fair and at the Italian exhibition at Earls Court in London. What stood out in his beds, chairs, tables, and desks was his ability to daringly pair extremely diverse materials: parchment, exotic woods, metal, knotted silk ropes, and tassels, and also to eclectically harmonize shapes coming from different cultures, so Africa, Japan, Persia. Two additional elements made his work noticeable: the transposition of architectural forms into decorative motifs, and the transformation of furniture into a synesthetic piece, appealing to different senses. Bugatti began to adopt his trademark horseshoe or keyhole shape after his travels to North Africa in the 1880s, modeling architectural arches into stylistic figures for his furniture. Drawing from the synesthetic poetics of the scapigliati, he planned his objects as ideal canvases, abstract compositions, and tactile structures through the alternation of geometric and pictorial motifs, the use of fringes, and the depiction of animals on wood, mainly snails or cobras. After his recognition in London and Milan in 1888, Bugatti opened his own laboratory in Brera, and a couple of years later, in 1890, he opened his workshop in Paris. As his fame grew, Bugatti showcased his work at international expositions, at the Exposition of Turin in 1898 and at the Universal Exposition of Paris of 1900. Where his exotic oriental style earned him a silver medal in furniture design. The Paris Exposition was a bittersweet moment for him. After being awarded the prize, his Parisian apprentice, Eugenio Quarti, then began his independent path, focusing on a more classical style and a new model of serial production. In Paris, Bugatti also saw the paintings of the Engadine Valley his friend and brother-in-law Segantini completed right before his sudden death in 1899. Bugatti's triumph came in 1902 at the first International Exposition of Modern Decorative Arts in Turin, where he was awarded the Diploma of Honor for his design of the Camera a Chiocciola, snail room, and his Cobra chair. The room was the most mature expression of his eclectic style, both in the use of his trademark keyhole design and in the fusion of elements from architecture, the animal world, and different exotic traditions. His chair, inspired by the chairs of African chieftains, and made of tropical woods, painted parchment, and hammered copper, would become one of the most iconic pieces of Italian design. As the grand jury put it, Bugatti was the first person in Italy to create, and not just dream, of a modern style of furniture. After his definitive move to Paris in 1904, Bugatti developed projects for the department store Bon Marché, displayed his silverware collections at the Galerie Ebrard, and presented his work at the Salon des Artistes Décorateurs, the Salon of Artist Decorators, in 1910 and 1911. The periodical Art et Décoration, Art and Decoration, repeatedly reviewed his style of jewelry and furniture, which mixed naturalistic elements with animal themes, and acclaimed Bugatti as the most original and influential designer in European Art Nouveau. Bugatti's exotic eclecticism, merging architecture, painting, and foreign influences in individual and unique pieces, ultimately came down to one simple theory: that any object, no matter what its function, can be turned into a work of art. Albeit in different ways, this idea would also be the key influence for the contemporary work of his sons, Rembrandt and Ettore. Rembrandt embodied the artistic vein of his father as a sculptor of exotic animals, mostly elephants, panthers, and lions. Starting from a visit to the zoo in Antwerp with his father, he had developed a promising artistic path in the early 1900s, a path which was interrupted by his premature death in 1916. As an homage to his talent, his brother Ettore would replicate Rembrandt's Dancing Elephant of 1908 on the silver radiator tap of his Bugatti Royal Automobile of 1928. Ettore also followed in his father's footsteps, as evidenced by their common passion for bicycles and their common idea of making any object a work for art, even an automobile, as we'll see. Following his father Carlo, who also assembled bicycles in his Milan workshop, Ettore started his first apprenticeship at age 16 in the Milanese mechanical laboratory of the bicycle manufacturer Prinetti and Stucchi. A year into the job, in 1898, he built the first motorized tricycle, now known as the Bugatti Type 1. After the prize awarded to his second prototype, the Type 2, at the Milan Trade Fair of 1901, the German car maker Adrian de Turckheim offered Ettore the opportunity to design automobiles at his Lorraine Dietrich factory in Alsace, which at the time was part of Germany. After relocating, Ettore designed for Dietrich the Type 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, and started his own entrepreneurial path, eventually leading to the foundation of his own company, Automobiles Bugatti, in the Alsatian town of Molsheim in 1909. This would be the start of the glorious brand of luxury cars, whose headquarters are now located in the nearby city of Dörlisheim. The roots of its success lie in Ettore's personal conception of engineering as his own way to art, which he developed in his family laboratory, where design, sculpture, and creative thinking continuously overlapped. As for his father's balancing of heterogeneous forms, materials, and cultural imports in furniture making, Ettore similarly saw in automobiles the expression of a dynamic harmonization of different mechanic components in an artistic whole. Meanwhile, in 1910, Carlo moved his atelier to Pierrefonds, a village outside Paris near the Marne, where he also served as mayor between 1914 and 1918. After the war, he was entrusted with the care of the local hotel Domaine Dubois, where he worked as a painter throughout the 1920s. In 1935, at the age of 79, he moved with his wife Teresa to Alsace, which had been returned to France after World War I. He lived in Molsheim near the factory of his son Ettore and died in April 1940. Right after the sudden death in a car accident of his grandson, Jean Bugatti, visionary engineer of the Type 57C. A few months later, the Germans invaded France. The Nazis would confiscate Ettore's company, which would only be returned to him on June 20, 1947, 2 months before his death on August 21st. Carlo Bugatti's heritage extends beyond his influence on Ettore, as his son's French automobile company, now part of the Volkswagen Group, continues to be an iconic symbol of art and luxury. Carlo's style also had a profound impact on furniture making, as both an art and an industry. Bugatti is now widely regarded as one of the most valuable interpreters of the Italian Liberty style, as confirmed by the inclusion of his works in the collection of the most important international museums, like the Musée d'Orsay in Paris, the Victoria and Albert Museum in London, the Museum of Decorative Arts in Milan, the Metropolitan Museum in New York, the Watson Collection in Miami, and the Montreal Museum of Fine Arts. At the same time, Bugatti is also recognized as the forerunner of a great generation of Italian furniture designers, which includes, among others, his apprentice, Eugenio Quarti, Carlo Zen, and Vittorio Ducrot, who worked in Sicily with the architect Ernesto Basile. In their hands, the Liberty style turned from an expression of unique artistry, as in Bugatti's original idea of turning single pieces into artwork, into a prototyping language, modeling an intermediate manufacture, halfway between craft and mass production, or rather, a new hybrid form of industrial product, neither fully standardized nor entirely individualized. The experimental season of Liberty was also the fertile soil for the later success of Italian furniture making in the post-war years of the economic boom, as seen in the affirmation of top interior designers like Gio Ponti, Achille Castiglioni, Gae Aulenti, and the formation of iconic brands like Zanotta, Cassina, Caligaris, and Roberto Cavalli. Italian excellence in furniture making is now confirmed by the Salone del Mobile in Milan, the world's largest and most important showroom in the industry, and by the country's position as a major furniture exporter on the international market. In the words of Paola Antonelli, senior design curator at New York's Museum of Modern Art, "Nowhere else in the world can one find so many varied examples, both in terms of conception and of formal outcome, so many applications of diverse forms from fashion and graphics to product and set design, such an extensive and multifaceted documentation recorded in literature, and such an international resonance." It all started in a classroom, in the encounter of two artists at Brera in the 1870s, a brother introducing his sister to a friend, but the artistic trajectory of Carlo Bugatti extends way beyond his life, expanding to museums, furniture, and automobile manufacturing, and closing its circle now with the new furniture line opened by the Bugatti car maker. Sometimes we don't fully appreciate this, but a fruit-bearing activity lasts much longer than its immediate effects. Our privilege is to see them in the long run as fully developed industrial stories. Thank you very much for watching. I invite you to subscribe to this YouTube channel or to the webpage www.italianinnovators.com to receive notifications of new episodes, the lessons of the Italian Innovators course, and updates about my online lectures. You can also follow Italian Innovators on LinkedIn, Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter for additional materials about the show. Thanks again. Arrivederci e alla prossima.